Hi folks, today I'd like to read a little bit of scripture for you about Cain and Abel. I'm sure most of you remember the story, but how the story is actually written is pretty important to hear. So let me start with Genesis chapter 4 and the story of Cain and Abel. Adam lay with his wife Eve, and she became pregnant and gave birth to Cain. So Cain's the older. She said, "With the help of the Lord, I have brought forth a man." Later, she gave birth to Cain's brother Abel. Now Abel kept flocks, and Cain worked the soil. In the course of time, Cain brought some of the fruits of the soil as an offering to the Lord. But Abel, he brought fat portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. The Lord looked with favor on Abel and his offering. But on Cain and his offering, the Lord did not look with favor. So Cain was very angry, and his face was downcast. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It, sin, desires to have you, but you must master it." Now Cain said to his brother Abel, "Let's go out in the field." And while they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Where is your brother?"
"I don't know," Cain replied. "Am I my brother's keeper?"
And the Lord said, "What have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Now you are under a curse and driven from the ground, which opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you work the ground, it will no longer yield its crops for you. You will be a restless wanderer on the earth." Cain said to the Lord, "My punishment is more than I can bear. Today you are driving me from the land, and I will be hidden from your presence. I will be a restless wanderer on the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me." But the Lord said to Cain, "Not so. If anyone kills Cain, he will suffer vengeance seven times over." Then the Lord put a mark on Cain so that no one who found him would kill him. So Cain went out from the Lord's presence and lived in the land of Nod, east of Eden. We know the land of Nod is the land of sleep. Remember the Lord's words? "Wake up, O sleeper." Okay, we're not going to go there. But we do want to discuss what's taken place in this story of Cain and Abel, and I'll tell you why. There's a portion of scripture. I'll just punch in Cain, that's all I can think. Four books, but I know it's New Testament. Hebrews, perhaps. "By faith, Abel offered God a better sacrifice than Cain did. By faith, he, Abel, was commended as a righteous man when God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith, he still speaks, even though he is long dead." That's in Hebrews. In the book of 1 John, chapter 3, "Do not be like Cain,
who belonged to the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own actions were evil, and his brother's were righteous. Here it is. It says that what I'm looking for specifically is found in Jude. Jude just has one chapter. It's verse 11. It says, "Woe to them who have taken the way of Cain. They have rushed for profit into Balaam's error. They have been destroyed in Korah's rebellion. These men are blemishes at your love feasts, eating with you without the slightest qualm. Shepherds, you hear that? Shepherds who feed only themselves. They are clouds." Remember, clouds are witnesses. "They are clouds without rain." Rain is understanding. "Blown along by the wind. Autumn trees without fruit and uprooted, twice dead. Not only is their flesh going to perish, that which is mortal, but their souls will perish as well." Twice dead. And it goes on. So anyways, the sin of Cain is something to be avoided. Therefore, I believe it's only important that we really delve into this sin of Cain, you know, and find out exactly what it is. One of the ways to find out what it is that to find out what Abel's offering, what was his sacrifice, and his sacrifice was righteous and Cain's sacrifice was evil. Boy. Well, lots of people will say that, you know, Abel killed a sheep, brought a blood offering, you know, to the Lord. No, he didn't. Other people will say, oh, Cain, you know, he grew, had a vegetable garden, and he brought produce from his garden. No, he didn't. We're going to find out what they offered. So, we're going to start. I'm going to start by making one simple statement. And I'm going to show you why that statement's accurate, why it's correct. My statement is that the word fat in Scripture, do you remember? Abel brought fat portions from the flock. Fat portions. Don't think of, I've got quite a chin, you know. I got a big belly. That's not the fat it's talking about. Fat in Scripture is pride. Pride. Let's go to Jeremiah 5:27. Now, keep this in mind as we're reading. Fat represents pride. "Like cages full of birds, their houses are full of deceit. They have become rich and powerful and have grown fat and sleek. Their evil deeds have no limit. They do not plead the case of the fatherless to win it. They do not defend the rights of the poor." They're so self-righteous, it makes me sick. Let's go to Leviticus 3:17. See what this says. Keeping in mind again, the word fat is a word that figuratively means pride. "This is a lasting ordinance for the generations to come. Wherever you live, you must not eat any fat or any blood." We know from previous videos, blood is figurative of contempt. Don't eat of contempt. Don't. But here we also have a command, don't eat of any fat. And I'm telling you, fat represents pride. Let's go to Ezekiel 39. Ezekiel 39:19. "At the sacrifice I am preparing for you, you will eat fat till you are glutted, and drink blood till you are drunk." This is something that's going to come. It's talking about us. We'll eat fat in the end, and we'll drink blood. Well, do you really think we're going to turn into a bunch of cannibals or something?
Nope.
It's talking about something else. Deuteronomy 32:13. Through 15. Speaking of Jacob, God's chosen people, this is what it says. He made him ride on the heights of the land, Jacob, and fed him with the fruit of the fields. He nourished him with honey from the rock and with oil from the flinty crag, with curds and milk from herd and flock, and with fattened lambs and goats, with choice rams of Bashan and the finest kernels of wheat. You drank the foaming blood of the grape. Jeshurun grew fat and kicked. Full of blood of food, he became heavy and sleek. He abandoned the God who made him and rejected the rock, his savior. God's chosen ones certainly do make a mistake, don't they? So when they reject God, their savior, the rock, their savior, and they abandon the God who made them, then it's because they're too fat. They're heavy and sleek. In other words, too friggin' arrogant and too prideful. Fat equals pride. Let's go back to Genesis chapter 4 and back to Cain and Abel's sacrifice. So we read that Abel kept flocks. Well, I'm certainly all of you understand what the flock is. Eh? There's many flocks in many, many places in the world, you know, but the Lord is seeking one flock, you know, one shepherd, one flock. It's talking about people. It's not talking about little four-legged critters. It's talking about people. So Abel kept flocks. He looked after folks, while Cain worked the soil. The soil's the ground. It's from which man came, rather than man. It's from which man came. Man came from that which is created. So Cain is worshiping the created. Abel is worshiping the Creator. Truth and love in man. In the course of time, Cain brought some of the fruits of the soil and offered them to the Lord. Look what I did. Look what I did, he's saying. I did this, I discovered that, I built this. He's looking at everything that's created, and he's bragging about it. Abel, however, brought fat portions from some of the firstborn of the flock. Fat portions, pride portions, humility. Abel offered to the Lord, he taught the people about humility. Now some of you are going to say, oh, you're full of it. Adam and Eve were the first two people on the planet. Cain and Abel were their first two children. There was nobody else. Well, then you tell me this word, Cain. Where's the land of Nod, and where did Cain get his wife? We didn't read that portion, but if you just go a little bit farther in the chapter, you'll read about Cain taking a wife. Where'd he get his wife? Well, Adam and Eve are the first of God's chosen. Doesn't mean they're the first humans on the planet. The animals all came before Adam and Eve. Let's turn to Psalm 51, start at verse 15. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, this you will not despise. Let's go to Isaiah 66, verse 2. The Lord is speaking. Has not my hand made all these things, and so they came into being, declares the Lord? This is the one I esteem. He who is humble and contrite in spirit and trembles at my word. But whoever sacrifices a bull is like one who kills a man, and whoever offers a lamb like one who breaks a dog's neck. Whoever makes a grain offering is like one who presents pig's blood, and whoever burns memorial incense like one who worships an idol. They have chosen their ways, and their souls delight in their abominations. Maybe it seems to me it says somewhere, I didn't ask the sacrifice of bulls, goats. Let's look at Isaiah chapter 1, verse 10. Hear the word of the Lord, you rulers of Sodom. Listen to the law of our God, you people of Gomorrah. My last video we spoke of Sodom and Gomorrah, didn't we? The multitude of your sacrifices, what are they to me, says the Lord? I have more than enough burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fattened animals. I have no pleasure in the blood of bulls and lambs and goats. When you come to appear before me, who has asked this of you, this trampling in my courts? Stop bringing meaningless offerings. Your incense is detestable to me. New moons, Sabbaths, and convocations, I cannot bear your evil assemblies. So God didn't ask for the, you know, animal sacrifice. He never asked for that. People say, oh yeah, that's what they used to do. No, that's not what they used to do. Not the true sons of God. No, that's not what they did. The people who were the counterfeits, the deceivers, oh yeah, that's what they taught. Yeah, that's what they did. Yeah. You killed animals. This is for you, God. That isn't what God asked for. Never asked for that. People go back to the days of Moses and say, oh yeah, that's what he had. No, it's not. No, it's not. Fat equals pride. God loves a humble man. He loves a man who trembles when he hears the word of the Lord. I wrote to a gentleman on my website, or my channel page on YouTube, and he had written me and he had quoted a portion of scripture that I have already read to you, you know. On this one will I look, on him who is poor and of contrite spirit and who trembles at my word. Well, this gentleman's absolutely right. So I wrote him back and I said, you hit the nail right on the head with that portion of scripture. As long as we understand what that portion of scripture is talking about, the ones God looks upon favorably are the poor, who are those who do not know God nor understand what God wants of them. Yet, when they hear the gospel which reveals God and his identity, they tremble with fear, knowing full well that they need forgiveness because they are contrite in mind and heart. Contrite means apologetic, chastened, penitent, remorseful, repentant, ashamed, conscience-stricken, guilt-ridden, sorrowful, humbled, and sorry. Many hear, but Christ revealed to them produces no fear, nor any respect, nor any pleading for forgiveness. God does not look favorably upon people like that. In fact, it says in the Word that God despises the arrogant, the proud, the boastful, and the rebellious. Now think of Cain's sin. He brought that which he had, you know, he planted the seed and bragged about his magnificent crop. God's the one who made it grow, not Cain. But Cain wanted to take the credit for it, didn't he? God's the one who sends the sunshine, the seasons, the rain. Cain drops a seed in the ground, thinks he's something big. He's bragging, isn't he? He's bragging about what he'd done. Big mistake. Big mistake. Abel, he teaches people to be humble. Be like that little guy that went to the temple to pray. Remember there were two men who went to the temple to pray? One man, a Pharisee. Pharisee goes in, he stands up there before God and he says, "Thank you, Lord. You blessed me so. I am so blessed." Not like other people. That sinner standing there beside me. That tax collector. Blah. Sinning every day. Full of sin. Evil little man. That'd be like me. I tithe. Keep myself pure. Take care of my body. Don't smoke. Don't drink. Don't do drugs. Go to church. Read my Bible. Oh yeah, I'm righteous. But him. Meanwhile, the tax collector, the poor man, he dared not even lift his head, but simply said, "Lord, forgive me. I know I'm a sinner. I know I'm a sinner. No, I'm a worthless piece of dung. I understand that. I'm just a man. I'm not God. Please forgive me." You know what it says? It says that that man went home justified before God. Because God looks with pleasure upon the man who humbles himself before him. But God despises the arrogant little bastards who think their shit don't stink. Take it to heart. Don't fall for the sin of Cain. Offer the sacrifice of Abel. You'll go far. Jesus is Lord. And love is what he asks. And please don't forget that love starts with loving God. Jesus is his name. Bye for now.